everyone. Welcome to episode 4 of A Knitter's Nest. My name is Lisa. This is a podcast about knitting, spinning, fleece prep, and other adventures in crafting. I can be found on Ravelry and Instagram as LiliKnits2, and on YouTube under the A Knitter's Nest channel. So today is Friday, June 24th, 2016, and it's midsummer here in Chicago. I'm in the suburbs of Chicago. I really appreciate you tuning into my channel. I know there's a lot of podcasts out there, and it's great that some of you have been able to find me and are paying attention and looking forward to another episode. So today I'm going to talk about knitting, spinning, and fleece preparation, and a little bit of inspiration at the end. So So today's the 24th of June. There was just Britain had just they've just voted to exit the European Union, and we really don't know what that's going to look like. I do hope that everyone in the UK, I'm sure a lot of people are reeling from the results of the vote. And I don't really understand everything about it, but I certainly hope that everybody in the UK is able to survive and do well with the upcoming changes. So because of that, I thought I would talk about one of my favorite spindle makers a little bit later, who actually lives in the Isle of Wight, and show you some of his beautiful, beautiful work and his spindles. Today I'm having a little bit of cider, to try to relax myself a little bit so that I can film this podcast before my husband comes home. I really don't know how I'm going to be able to do this once I start work again, but we'll just cross that bridge when we come to it. I do hope everybody is well, and wherever you are, you're enjoying the summer or the winter, wherever you are in the world. So let's start today with some knitting. I was inspired by a couple of the podcasters that I listened to watch the Camibornia podcast, and I got sucked into doing a KAL, a knit along, which I normally don't do because I'm notoriously bad at being able to actually finish the project in the time frame that they specify. But the project was so cute that I thought I would go ahead and try it. So it's the Small Flowers Mitts by Pina Guri. I think I talked about this last time I podcast. So I have completed one of the mitts. I did this all yesterday. I was so proud of myself. Everything else suffered, you know, housework, cooking, laundry, all that suffered. But I made my first mitt. This is entirely out of hand spun. I do have to knit this is the waist yarn, this yellow here. I do have to pick up stitches and do the thumb, but I'm very inexperienced with color work, and it was really showing in this project. When I took it off the needles and I first tried it on, the color work was quite tight around my wrist, because I think that even though I thought I was relaxing the floats on the back of the work, I'll show you what that means. When you do stranded work, you carry colors along, and of course I didn't do what they suggest to weave the ends in before you need them, and then weave the new yarn in before you need it, and then you don't have ends to weave in. But you know, I too many things to figure out at once, you know, just tensioning the yarn. I use the two-handed method, so I'm a thrower or English style knitter by preference, but I can also knit with my left hand. So I kept the pattern colors in my left hand and the gray in my right hand. And as you can see, these are the floats, and some of them are very, very tight. But in the end, I think it's going to be okay, because it's snug right around my wrist, which is really what you want. So it's almost like a bracelet around my wrist, and I'm just in love with this pattern. I could see myself making more of these. And it's a great pattern. Look for a newbie stranded work knitter that I am. It's a great project for that. And you really, once you start these flowers here, you can't stop. It's like you become obsessed. You have to finish the flowers before you get to the hand. And then the rest of the hand has this eyelet pattern, which I think I might have screwed up, but I'm very pleased with the result so far. And so this morning I got up and I started the second one. Now Pia of the Camabornia podcast said in her Ravelry group that the pictures have to be posted by the 24th of June to be what eligible for a prize or whatever. I don't really care about that. I just wanted to do the project. But I was hoping I could get them done. But, you know, since Europe is 8 or 10 hours ahead of us, I knew I wasn't going to be able to get it in time. But, you know, that's fine. But this morning I got up and I knit this one. I had done the cuff last night, and then I did the color work this morning. So, you know, when you're doing these flowers, you start to think, oh, I could make it in, you know, pink. Or you think about all the different color combinations that you could use. And I'm extra super pleased with these because they're completely out of my hand spun. So I'll show you what I used. This was the gray Corriedale alpaca that I had spun this winter. And then all my, and this is the white, which I spun long draw. This is a Corriedale baby alpaca blend that I blended using my hand cards, which I'm going to do a demonstration of that a little bit later. So, you know, if you're not interested in the spinning part of the fleece prep of the podcast, you can just kind of skip over that part. But I spun this long draw on my big wheel, and I really love how it turned out. It's just your typical woolen yarn, very light and airy and just lovely and really lovely to work with. So these are the colors that I spun. These were all, here, I'll show you what they look like. These were all spindle spun on my Turkish spindles. And these are the Wildflowers Pack by Hilltop Cloud. And I was a little bit hesitant to knit the mitts in hand spun because I was worried about gauge. Because the pattern recommends a fingering weight yarn or a 4-ply. And this is definitely a little bit thicker than that. So I was a little bit worried that it was going to be, it's not there, but it was going to be too thick. But it actually worked out perfectly. So the needles that I'm using are Addy Bamboo 3mm, and I'm using the magic loop method, which that's another thing I'm not super experienced with. But I thought that it's a really great way to do color work because you can just do the front of the mitten and then the back of the mitten, and you don't have to fiddle with the floats over the DPNs that you're working with. I actually started another color work mitten that I forgot to bring that I started last year that I never finished. So I'm hoping that once I finish these, I'll be inspired to go back and finish those other mittens. So, yeah, but I'm super excited. You know, it's 82 degrees Fahrenheit outside, and I'm making woolen mittens, but I'm really, really happy with them. So let's see, what else was there about the mitts I wanted to mention? I had to go on YouTube to figure out how to carry the yarn. So evidently when your yarn, the color you're not using goes over more than about an inch, you want to catch the yarn with the other color you're working with. So I went to YouTube and I found an excellent video, which I will put in the show notes, that shows you how to kind of catch the non-working yarn in the middle of the work so that it doesn't create this big long float on the back, which would catch on, say, your ring or your fingers or something like that. So I had to figure that out too. So but yeah, super excited. I have a lot to learn when it comes to color work. I have a Alice Starmore pattern in mind that I want to make. It's just a cowl. It's just I think it's the Maud cowl. I bought a kit a couple years ago. I tend to, with knitting, I just sort of jump right in, and I don't know always what I'm getting into when I think I want to do a project. But now I think after these mitts, I think I could do that project. So Maybe I'll show you that to you next time. So yeah, it was a lot of fun, especially using my own hand spun, which, you know, hand spun is just extra special. So that's the thing that's been really occupying my knitting time these last couple of days. The other thing that I have on the needles that I'm actively working on is the Quicksand cardigan by Heidi Kermeyer. I think I brought this up last time I podcast. I did pull it out of hibernation. I figured out where I was, and I'm on my way to finishing the body. Now, she has you do these short rows in the back to make the back a little bit longer than in the front. So what a short row is a partial row. So instead of knitting all the way across, you knit to the specified number of stitches, and then you turn around, and then sort of you knit back and forth, so it creates this extra fabric. And people use short rows to shape, you know, cap sleeves, or to shape the bust in a sweater, or if you want a little bit extra room in the hips. And there's lots of different ways to do short rows, but that's one of the techniques that's really intimidated me. I think I did the Vera Valamecki shawl stripe study uses short rows, but it's in garter and you don't have to do any wrap and turn. I looked at a class that Carol Feller had filmed about short rows, and I did some swatches and some experiments, but I still, you know, I don't feel 100% comfortable with short rows, but I think it's going to be fine. I'm knitting this out of Quince & Company Kestrel, which is organic linen. This is the Minos colorway, and it's a dusty purple. A couple things about this yarn. Oh, I'm knitting it on 5.5 millimeter needles, which is a US 9. It has this tape construction. I don't know if you can see this. It's like a tape. And it's very interesting knitting, because as you knit, I throw, so I'm adding a twist to the yarn as I knit. So what will happen is after several stitches, my yarn will do this. Which is kind of annoying. I mean, I suppose it's normal. So every once in a while, I was clipping in this untwisting, because just the twisting was bothering me, and I thought maybe it'll impact the fabric. But now what I'm doing is just, as I'm knitting with it and it twists up, I just take my finger and I just pull it along here, and I just sort of drag that twist into the ball and then just keep knitting. But I don't know, I'm a wool lover, you know, so I'm not sure how I feel about the linen. It's quite rough to the touch right now. I know Melody of Mandarin Knits was talking about linen. This linen is just absolutely beautiful, though. I mean, it's the color is gorgeous, and it's just expertly spun in Italy. It's by Quince & Company. So after I finish these mitts, I'm going to work on this and see if I can get it done so that I could actually wear it now in the summer and the fall months. So it's quite rough, but I've been told that as you wash linen and dry it over the time, it gets more soft. It's softer and, you know, more beautiful as you wear it. It's knit at quite a loose gauge, but I did make gauge with the recommended needles. So I'm just going to trust Heidi Kermeyer, who is the writer of the pattern, because she pretty much knows what she's doing. So I'm not doing any modifications of the garment, but this would be my second finished garment after my Nanook, which was also a Heidi Kermeyer pattern. So I think I have a couple others of her in my library. But yeah, very easy to follow. Her patterns use this chart format, so you have to highlight, instead of parenthetically telling you how many stitches to knit for each size, she has a chart, and so you just highlight the the column that you need to work with, and you know, she'll say knit K stitches, and then you go to the chart and you look there. So it's really an interesting and unique way of presenting the pattern, and really she walks you through everything single step. So the other thing I wanted to talk about with this is the joining of the yarn. You know, when I was planning this podcast today, I thought, you know, I really don't even have enough to talk about for 30 minutes. But now I realize I'm 60 minutes in, and I'm definitely going to need to edit this quite a bit so to make it not so lengthy. But when you, join a new yarn, since linen is so slippery, there's a couple ways that you can join. One of the ways that I did at the beginning was as I was coming to the end of one ball, and they're quite small. I think each skein only has, it's 50 grams and 76 yards. So that's a lot of ends to weave in. So one of the suggestions I had read was to, as you come to the end of one ball, you start the new one and then you knit the two together for quite a little while and try to do it in an inconspicuous place, like in the back, and then just start knitting with the new ball. So I had done that before I had put it in hibernation. Well, since then I read about this Russian join, which is a little bit more work, but I think it's going to be well worth it. And I will put a link in my show notes, but basically it has you take, use a needle and you thread the yarn with a very, very sharp tapestry needle. And then you weave it into itself. So you do a loop. And then you do it, and so you have this loop here, and then you do it with the other yarn, and then you pull them into the two loops will meet, and then you can easily trim off the excess, and it's a very, very sturdy join, and there's no ends to weave in. So it's a little bit more fiddly, but I think I'm going to do that for the rest of the sweater, but I kind of had wished I had, I'm in the middle of a row here, so, but you can see I have these extra, all these ends that I'm going to have to weave in, which, you know, I don't really, frankly, I don't mind weaving in ends. It's kind of, you know, just do it while you're watching TV or whatever, but I feel like I was wasting a lot of yarn too. This is very dear, very expensive yarn, so stay tuned for that. I'm hoping to get this done very, very soon. So those are the two main things that I have been working on, the mitts and the cardigan. My shawl hasn't gotten any love whatsoever. Well, maybe a row or two, but you know, nothing much. All right, so let me have a look at my knits here. I did want to talk about one last thing. I use a short rows, and I had purchased this magazine at my local Joann's. It's called Knit Scene Handmade. And in here is an excellent overview of the different short row techniques by Bristol Ivy, which I think she designs for Quince and Company. I'm not sure, but got four methods. And the method I'm going to use for my my quicksand cardigan is this one here, the shadow wraps. Let's see here. No, it's Japanese short rows here. There's shadow wraps. And it's kind of neat because it sort of uses the lifted increase that's already been incorporated into the cardigan. That's how Heidi Kirmayer does increases, called lifted increase. So I swatched, I practiced, and I'm pretty excited that I think I'll be able to tackle the short rows. So, you know, always something new to learn in knitting. So, which is, you know, the thing that appeals to me about knitting is there's always something new to learn. You could certainly knit the same item over and over and over again and never learn any new techniques or anything like that, but I'm sort of trying to push myself to challenge myself to learn some of the new techniques. So as far as my, I'm not going to show you a lot of spinning today. I did spindle spin all my colors for the color work mittens that I talked about just a minute ago. But I did want to talk a little bit about a favorite spindle maker. And his name is Ian Tate. And he lives in the Isle of Wight. And he makes the most beautiful Turkish spindles. And he also makes drop spindles. I have one of his. And he makes support spindles, which I'm not very good at spinning with support spindles yet, but I have, I think I have two of his. I have a Russian and a Tibetan that he made. But in light of what's going on in Britain, I thought I'd talk about one of my favorite spindle makers. So this is one that I'm working with. This was the first spindle, the first Turkish spindle that I had ever received. And I actually didn't buy this one. My husband bought this one for me for Christmas a couple years ago. And I didn't really even know how to use it or, you know, I was very tentative about a lot of things in life. But for some reason, spinning and knitting, I just jump right in the butterfly it up. But this is, I thought it was so tiny. But this, I think it's satinwood. And the thing about Turkish is that you can get quite a light spindle in weight. And you can really get some pretty fine singles on a very lightweight spindle. Now, I guess he's been trained as a woodworker for the music instrument industry. And he says that he's been inspired. The shape of the spindle is very unique to him. And he's been inspired by, you know, the violin and the violin bow. So very, very beautiful, beautifully turned, perfectly balanced spindle. So this was the first spindle that I'd ever actually received or spun on. And here I am spinning Alizé Fiber Arts, a BFL. Mohair blend, and it's this beautiful. It was so funny today. I'm trying to plan for my podcast, and I was deciding what spindle projects to talk about, and I found about half a dozen, and I'm sure there's a few more lurking around somewhere, but what can you do? But this is the fiber. BFL mohair, and it's purples, and it's showing a little blue on my camera now, but it's purple and pinks, and I'm thinking socks. You know, BFL is a long wool. It's one of the softest long wools there is, and I'm thinking it's going to make good sock yarn, because BFL having a longer staple will be longer wearing, and the mohair acts as they call it nature's nylon. It's a very strong, it can be a very strong fiber. So far I have spun this little turtle, and then I had spun some on a regular drop spindle, and what I did is I just wound it off using my ball winder. I find that to ply with spindle spun yarn, doing a plying ball is the way to go, where you take you've got all your little bits and bobs that you've spun, and you just make a plying ball with the two strands, or the three strands, I guess, if you want to do a three ply, and then you make a ball with the two strands, and then you just ply right off the plying ball. Really, it really worked like a charm with my others. So that's one of the spindle projects I have with his spindles. He has an Etsy shop. It's called IST Crafts. He also has a website that I had ordered from before, where you actually sort of custom order the spindle you want. When you order from his website, it takes a little bit longer. With the Etsy shop, he has an update, and you place your order, and you get it relatively quickly. I mean, if you live in the U.S., it takes a while. Royal Mail takes a little while to get here, but it's well worth the wait, and I highly recommend his spindles. I thought I'd show you just a couple more. This one is a little bit bigger and a little bit heavier. I believe this is Santos rosewood. And again, it's got that characteristic shape. I think I saw somebody on Etsy that made one that looked similar, but this is his design. I mean, I don't think you can make a patent on spindle designs, but. And I am spinning this, keeping a British theme here, Wensleydale fiber with that. So I'm not sure what I'm going to do with this. I'm spinning another one on my Enid Ashcroft, one of my Enid Ashcroft spindles, who's also a UK maker. So I'm not really sure as I said, I was running around the house trying to figure out what am I spinning? So I think it's a good idea to take out the shaft when you store it so it won't get broken if it's smushed or something. And let's see, I can show you a couple more. You can see I'm really a fan. This is another braid by Beth Ann of Alozie Fiber Arts. And this one is called Snowless Winter. And it's BFL, Kid Mohair, and Silk. This winter in parts of the U.S. was really unusual. Places that normally get a lot of snow didn't get snow. So she was inspired to this braid here, Snowless Winter. So it's got browns and blues. Basically what the earth looks like when it's winter and there's no snow. So yeah. So I'm spinning this one on another one of Ian's spindles. This one is made out of pink ivory wood, so sort of a reddish pink color. And it's just beautiful. Half hitch it, and it's like a little dancer when you watch it spin. I always think of that Elton John song Tiny Dancer when I do my spindle. So yeah, it's very relaxing. You can do it while you're talking or at a picnic or wherever. What I do is I butterfly it on the one hand, and then I do my over two, under one, over two, under one, over two, under one. But I am researching other ways that you can wind it on. I know Rachel of Woolen Spinning does sort of she makes a ball, and it's very, very quick, because this is a little bit time consuming, but I mean, it's slow yarn, right? I think I was trying to put myself on this, you know, I had to get the yarn spun and I had to get the mitts made by the 24th of June, you know, because I wanted to be part of this KAL, and I just put this arbitrary, you know, deadline on myself. And, you know, I think the podcast is going to be good in a lot of ways, but on the other hand, it kind of makes me feel like, oh, I got to get this done so, you know, I have something to show. I know Rachel's podcast has turned into more of a process driven, so not just the finished objects, but the process of actually making. So, yeah, very relaxing. And so, over two, under one, over two, under one, over two, under one, over two, under one. So, yeah, it's very, very relaxing. So yeah, I have to organize all my spindle projects because I've got many, many of them. You want to look at one? You want to see one more? I'll show you one more. I have two more in here, but I'll just show you one more. I think I'll show you this one. This was some fiber that I had purchased when I first started spinning. The first spindle that I spun on that really where spinning on a spindle really clicked was a Golding spindle. I bought a fairly heavy Golding spindle. They're so expensive. But I bought the cheapest one, and I think it's out of lignum vitae and walnut, and it's Golding spindles have these brass rings around the edges, around the ring, and it's got this wonderful long spin time. And I just all of a sudden it clicked. You know, I gave this spindle a thigh roll, and I was just able to spin. And why was I talking about this? Oh, so what I had received with the spindle was an inglenook fibers. No, I'd received a sample, and it was a fiber from a woman in Oregon. I think her name is, it's called Alexandra's Crafts. And I, unfortunately, that was before I realized that you should save your packaging and your ball bands so you actually know what it is you have. So that fiber was so beautiful that I ended up buying a braid. And this is it. This is all I have left. It's quite a mess here. I always make such a mess when I podcast. It takes me like a half an hour to put everything away. I'm going to have to figure out a more efficient way of doing this, but anyhow. And here it is. This is pink and yellow and purple. And very, very cheerful. So I have quite a bit of this actually already spun up. But I wanted to show you what a turtle looks like with a variegated yarn. Pretty, you know, creates this really pretty pattern, and even the back. So I was reading about the over two under one, and the reason you do over two under one is by doing over two, you're actually building a taller and cap, and putting more fiber on the top of the spindle, so you can pack more on. So that's what I didn't realize that that's really the reason you do it. So, but I've got a couple of these. I've got and then I've got another one here, which I had. So I got quite a bit of this spun up. And as I was going through all my fiber and my spindle projects, I found this one. And I thought, you know, I'm so close to being done. I really have to concentrate on one or maybe two projects. Because I think if you wait a long time in between spinning projects, you sort of forget how the thickness, and you know, if you pick it up a year later, you might be spinning quite a bit different. And I mean, I'm not at a stage right now where I can control completely my yarn diameter. So anyway, but I'm babbling. But yeah. Okay, hello again. I had a little trouble with my camera. My battery died. So, and my husband came home from work, so it's been about an hour and a half since I was last podcasting. And what had happened is the last 10 minutes of my podcast had been completely not filmed. So here I am one more time in my front room, and it's a little bit later in the day, and I did change the setting on the camera to see how this would affect the lighting. So I do apologize if there's some change in the resolution or brightness of the podcast, but I'm now having a nice cup of coffee with my little mug with the little red bird on it. Podcasters always talk about what they're drinking, but I know on one hand I'm thinking, why do people even care? But I'm having a cup of coffee, and I thought I would just finish up today and give a brief talk about hand cards and how I used hand cards to create these little, they're called rolags, which I had filmed, okay, which I had made with my hand carder. So this is a Corriedale alpaca blend, and this is what you use to spin traditional English long draw. So I thought I'd talk just briefly about the different types of cards and what cards I like to use, and a resource for you too if you want more information. So I have actually, I have four sets of cards. One set is very, very fine cotton or cashmere, and I don't use those at all, so I didn't even bring those up. But I thought I would talk to you about the three carders that I have. Okay, so this is what a hand card looks like. This is a Howard hand card. And it's basically a paddle with a handle. And it has what you call carding cloth. It's sort of like what you have on a flicker brush, but it's on the cards, like, so they're it's usually stapled on. Okay. And for every pair of hand cards you get, there is tines per inch or points per inch, and it's a measurement of how many pins you have on your cards. These, for example, are 90 TPI. So I bought these when I got my first fleece, and they were fine. They do have a flat handle, and but they're quite heavy, and they're not all that comfortable to use. So the second pair that I got, I have a lot of fiber tools, but are the Shocked. These are Shocked Spindle Company. They're renowned for their spinning wheels. I bought these from Susan's Fiber Shop. I called them up and ordered them. One thing you'll notice straight away is that these are curved, whereas the Howard are flat. And I actually find that I prefer the curved cards. These also have sort of a flattened handle right here at the tip. So depending on how you carry your cards, you know, you might find some that are more comfortable than others. These are 112 TPI, so they're considered fine carders. You would use these for finer fibers like merino, cormo, you know, any of the fine fibers, low micron count fibers. Though I find these great for Shetland. I've used these for Shetland yarn, Corriedale. I find them to be pretty useful, but they're not really my favorites. My favorite carders that I have are these. I'm a Clemis and Clemis fan. Just like Shocked and just like Howard, they're an American company. I think they're in California, yeah. And I had purchased these cards. Let's clean them off a little bit here. These are made out of cherry, and they have a round handle, and they have a curve. And these are 72 TPIs, which are a great all-around type of cards for almost any kind of wool. And I really find that to be the case. I have carded very fine Cormo, not Cormo, Corriedale on here, very fine Shetland alpaca, and they work beautifully. And they are my favorite. So, I mean, if I had to pick just one, these would be the ones that I would keep. So, you can learn to card by watching. There's a lot of videos online that you can look at. But so these are some of the things that you want to take into account when you are buying a pair of carders. You want to, and I'm getting this information from the Spinner's Book of Fleece by Beth Smith. I don't know if I've spoken about this book before. This is an excellent book about, you know, sheep breeds and fleece preparation techniques and tools. And if I had this at the beginning of my, you know, journey in fiber prep, this would have been really, really helpful to have. I got it after I knew quite a bit about how to prepare fiber and how to choose fleeces, but I still learned a ton from this book. And Beth goes through all the tools of fleece preparation, and she goes into detail about hand cards, and, you know, she talks about things to consider: comfort, weight, curve versus flat, and then pins per square inch. So she talks about all the different kinds of cards. And then later on, she goes through the hand carding techniques. And it's really a very detailed explanation. And it's her favorite method with curved back cards. But she's got different technique for flat back versus curved back, and making a traditional roleag. And just, you know, like I said, I'm by no means an expert. There's just a ton to know about this kind of stuff, but this is a great resource. You probably have seen this on other podcasts that have talked about fleece preparation. I think I got this on Amazon, and Yeah, it retails for $29.95, but it's really well worth the price. It's awesome. So what I did to make the yarn that I'm spinning in the opening segment of my podcast today is I took my carders and I used them to blend. So this is alpaca and this is the Corriedale, from Elizabeth Hubbard that I had purchased. Now I flicked the locks. So, you know, they say garbage in, garbage out. So if you have any neps or, you know, noils, I don't really know what the difference is, but in your fiber, it's just, if you don't take them out, they're going to end up creating inconsistent yarn. Like, I care about consistency. I mean, I do, but in any case, what I did is I sat outside the other day and I just took my Corriedale and I loaded the cards. Remember my first episode, I think it was second episode, I talked about Betty Hochberg's book, and she says just load on the fiber. So that's what I do. I load on a bunch of Corriedale, and then I took some of the alpaca that I had combed. Normally, combing is an end, you know, then you just spin from the comb top, but I wanted a blend, and I just didn't want all the veg matter in there. So I've got quite a bit of fiber on here. Many people would be like, oh, a gas, that's too much. But I it worked for me, so. Yeah. So what you're going to do, and I like to hold my card. I usually hold this in my lap. And I take my other cards. And what you're doing is you're brushing the fiber. It's like brushing your cat or your dog. So, you know, you just grab some fiber and you brush. You don't want to hear too much of this. You don't want to hear that. You don't want to dig the fibers into the tines of the carders. You just want to gently brush, just like you're brushing your kitty. You know, nice and easy. You don't want to hurt her. Now, what I find, supposedly what should happen, excuse me, is that all the fiber on this card should end up on this one. I don't know if it's because I overload my cards, but that usually doesn't happen. But I just keep carding and for a little while until it's nice and smooth. All right, so then I take this card, and I take I think this is called the heel of the card, and let's see if I can show this. And you go like this, and it gets transferred to that other card. So now all the fiber is here. And then I wanted to blend the alpaca and the Corriedale together. Now Beth says in her book that, you know, a lot of people think they must have a drum carder if they're going to process a lot of fleece, but she says that that's a myth, that you can actually prepare quite a lot of fiber just with hand cards, because when you drum card, you have to make sure everything is flicked and prepared kind of before you throw it in the carder. So now what I will do is I'll take this card, and again, I'm like Betty in my book. Betty Hochberg says don't worry about the order, you know, don't make a fetish of carding. So I have everything on this card again. And then I just probably do one more pass. Interweave Press has got some really great instructional materials that you can buy. I think there is one on carding. It's like four people and their different carding techniques. So what I'll do now is I think I've got everything pretty much smoothed. And so now I'll transfer this back on. And then I'll kind of do it again using just the bottom half of the card here. Sometimes if the fiber gets all bunched up along the top, it'll create like a ridge in my roll-ag, which I don't want. And yeah, you want to make sure and now I'm just going to make my roll-ag. So go once like that, and then once like that. Now they're released from the tines, set the other one down. What I do is I put this in my lap and I roll it like a cigar this way. So let's see if I can show that with the one hand. So like this. And I kind of just kind of tuck the end. I kind of tuck the ends in. So I get a big fat roll leg that's not itty bitty the size of my finger. It's a nice big fluffy cloud. That's absolutely perfect for long draw spinning. You just spin it like this. So, yeah. So it's a lot of fun. It's very therapeutic. Carding, it's, you know, you card and you sit out, maybe sit outside with a glass of wine or coffee or whatever, and then you just put them in a little basket, and then you got all those beautiful Rolex to spin. So I hope that was helpful, a little bit about cards. I'm just really fascinated by all the different tools, fiber tools. And someday, you know, I always think in another life, you know, maybe I might in my retirement do something, teach, or, you know, I'd love to have a studio, or I don't know. I'd love to do something in the fiber arts, but probably not very lucrative. So. Okay, so before I say goodbye today, I wanted to talk about a little inspiration segment. And it's about podcasts, and two in particular. The first podcast I wanted to mention was one that's actually no longer being filmed, and it was called Dark Matter Knits. It was Elizabeth Green Musselman. And she had this podcast that was so interesting. She is a history professor and a natural teacher. And in every podcast she has is a theme. And she discusses the theme, as well as showing her works in progress. And at the end of each episode, she has a tutorial and some things that are really, really useful. Like, for example, one episode she talked about how when you wind a ball of yarn on your ball winder and it sits in your stash for a really long time, it can actually get stretched out. So she has this technique you have to watch the video, but she has basically double wind it to make it so it's not so compressed in the ball. And you know, she just takes a particular little technique at the end. And I'm not sure why she stopped podcasting. I think life probably got in the way, and she had other responsibilities, but so intelligent, really the thinking woman's knitter, and you know, really pushes you to think kind of outside the box. So I've been rewatching all of her podcasts. I think she has 17 or 18, maybe. Yeah, Elizabeth. I hope she. I would love it if she would podcast again. And then the other one that I really love, and she's also on hiatus right now, but I suspect she will be back after her baby is born, is Isabel of the Fluffy Fibers podcast. And Isabel is not only a knitter and a spinner, but she is a seamstress. And she sews beautiful garments for herself, for her daughter, and now for her upcoming baby. I think she's due in July. It's so funny how you feel like you know people, like they're almost your friend when you listen to them in a podcast, though, you know, it's really just an illusion. But she's just a lovely person, and her podcasts are full of gorgeous projects and inspiration. So I know there's a gazillion podcasts out there, and you know, you kind of get overwhelmed with all the podcasts. There's just so many, but her podcasts are really—they're really meaty. They have content. They have finished objects, and she's just a very sweet and lovely person. So those are two podcasts that I really really like quite a bit. So. Well, I'm going to sign off now. I do appreciate you tuning in. I know that there are, you know, I'm never going to be one of the, I call them the Knitterati, you know, these podcasters that have, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 people, which kind of is hilarious since, you know, like real YouTubers that are popular have millions and millions of views. But, you know, in the niche market of knitters and spinners and crafters, I know there's some really super popular ones. So I don't really aspire to that too much, but, you know, I appreciate that you have been able to find me, and I hope that, you know, something I'm sharing maybe gives you some inspiration or ideas on what you might do in your crafting life. So I thank those people that have subscribed to my channel. It really means a lot to me. I'm still trying to figure out how I get on iTunes. I'm not sure if I even need to get on iTunes, but I'm going to look into that. We also have a very tiny, intimate group on Ravelry, a knitter's nest. And you know, a lot of the podcasters, they say, oh, you know, I have 1,000 member giveaway. I'm thinking maybe if I got 50 members or even 25, I might do a giveaway of maybe some of my fiber fleece locks or something like that. So that's probably going to be far out in the future. So, but I thank you again for tuning in and leaving comments, and I will see you on the internet, and till next week, have a good week. Bye-bye.